President. Hello, I'm Michael Holmes.
Hello, everyone. I'm Daljit Dhaliwal.
Well, it was a dreary Washington day, and the world said goodbye to the 40th president of the United States.
Former presidents, world leaders, past and present, and scores of dignitaries gathered for a majestic state funeral for Ronald Reagan, who died on Saturday after a long battle with Alzheimer's disease.
Bells tolled and a band played as the hearse bearing Reagan's casket arrived at the National Cathedral from where it had laid in state for 2 days as more than 100,000 mourners filed past. Friday's funeral capped 6 days of mourning marked by pomp, ritual and ceremony.
Those who knew him best delivered moving eulogies. The former Canadian Prime Minister Brian Mulroney said au revoir, as did Margaret Thatcher, the former British Prime Minister. She praised him as a man who won the Cold War and reshaped the world. Thatcher, whose health is too frail to permit her to speak, recorded a message in advance.
We live today in the world that Ronald Reagan began to reshape with those words. It is a very different world, with different challenges and new dangers. All in all, however, it is one of greater freedom and prosperity, one more hopeful than the world he inherited on becoming president.
May our common future and that of our great nations be guided by wise men and women who will remember always the golden achievements of the Reagan era and the success that can be theirs if the values of freedom and democracy are preserved unsullied and undiminished until the unfolding decades can remember little else.
Former President George Bush Sr. teared up as he recalled some personal moments.
More from Ronald Reagan than from anyone I encountered in all my years of public life. I learned kindness. We all did. I also learned courage. The nation did. Who can forget the horrible day in March 1981? He looked at the doctors in the emergency room and said, I hope you're all Republicans. And then I learned decency. The whole world did. Days after being shot, weak from wounds, he spilled water from a sink, and entering the hospital room, aides saw him on his hands and knees, wiping water from the floor. He worried that his nurse would get in trouble. The good book says, humility goes before honor, and our friend had both, and who could not cherish such a man?
And the current president, George W. Bush, said it was sad and hard to let him go.
Frightened by nothing. As he showed what a president should be, he also showed us what a man should be. Ronald Reagan carried himself, even in the most powerful office, with a decency and attention to small kindnesses that also define a good life. He was a courtly, gentle, and considerate man, never known to slight or embarrass others.
Hey.
Reagan's body will be flown back to California now for a private sunset burial, attended by family and special guests at his presidential library just north of Los Angeles. Well, we're joined now by our former World Affairs correspondent here at CNN, Ralph Begleiter. He is now Professor of Communication and a distinguished journalist in residence at the University of Delaware in Newark. Good to see you, Ralph. First of all, it's been some time since there's been a funeral of this magnitude in the US. Describe, if you will, before we get onto your own experiences covering Reagan, just for our foreign viewers, our international viewers, the importance of an event like this from a national standpoint.
Well, I don't think the last state funeral occurred since 1973. The one I remember from my childhood was the Kennedy funeral in 1963, and I do remember that making an enormous impression on me as a child and later as an adult, so I'm sure that this state funeral here in the United States will have a similar effect on people of today's younger generation. These are the kinds of events that bring Americans together and realize, just as they do in many other countries, of course, the nature of the government that they live under. This is a government in which rulers change, in which power shifts routinely, almost on schedule, either every 4 years or every 8 years in the United States. And so when state funerals are held, people in the United States are reminded that these leaders are revered, they've held positions of power, but they've moved on and they've done so without any struggle. I think that's one of the strong messages that these kinds of events carry for Americans.
Indeed. Ralph, it's very normal, I suppose, that there'd be a bit of myth-making around at a time like this, particularly in the immediate aftermath surrounding, I know, Ronald Reagan's foreign policy, his economic ideas, memories blurring reality into romance in some ways. Do you think that the coverage, from your own standpoint, what you're doing now, has been balanced?
Well, it's certainly very natural, and I think this happens almost wherever you are, for people in retrospect to take a rosier view of officials than maybe was the case when they were in office. And certainly, it's a little indecorous, really, on the day someone is being buried to be too critical of that individual. So I don't know whether balance is the right word, but clearly it'll take some time for Americans as well as people elsewhere in the world to form their opinions about Ronald Reagan in retrospect. We've seen 20 years go by since his presidency, and certainly I can recall covering his foreign policy at the time and remarking many times, both on and off the air, that I didn't think President Reagan was fully aware of the impact of his policies, and certainly not fully aware of the impact of what he said from time to time. I can remember news conferences at which the president was asked to comment on issues of foreign policy and cringing a bit at the kinds of things he would say. The whole world kind of had one of those moments when Mr. Reagan met Mikhail Gorbachev in Iceland in 1986. And I remember Margaret Thatcher and George Shultz, then his Secretary of State, almost being taken aback by the idea that Mr. Reagan had in effect agreed with President Gorbachev, Prime Minister Gorbachev at that time, of the Soviet Union, that the U.S. and Soviets ought to give up all their nuclear weapons. And that was just essentially agreed at the table right there in Iceland. And everybody had to kind of roll back and say, well, wait a minute, there's got to be a negotiation. And of course, we know, looking at it today, that neither of the two countries, neither Russia nor the United States, has given up all its nuclear weapons, even at this late date. My point is simply that I think Mr. Reagan was not the kind of person who could thoroughly understand international affairs and understand necessarily the impact that his own commitments and own remarks were having around the world.
And as you spent all those years, more years than you probably care to remember, Ralph, covering world affairs and under the Reagan administration in particular, is there a favorite memory? Is there a moment that leaps out to you that you'll never forget?
Well, actually, there are many favorite moments. I think really watching the denouement take place between the United States and then Soviet Union, realizing, and not realizing at the time, but realizing only in retrospect, that those were the steps leading to the end of the Cold War, the fall of the Berlin Wall, the reunification of Germany, and so on. I can remember being in Geneva in 1984, where George Shultz, the U.S. Secretary of State then, and Andrei Gromyko, then the Soviet Foreign Minister, met for the first time in what was really, in retrospect, the ice-breaking moment between the Cold War and the post-Cold War period. And it was in that meeting in Geneva that the two sides agreed that even though President Reagan had referred to the Soviet Union as the evil empire, he, Mr. Reagan, was going to meet with Mikhail Gorbachev. And that, of course, did happen in 1985, also in Geneva, which was the beginning at the presidential level of the steps that led to the end of the Cold War. Those certainly are very fond memories and, I think, important ones to realize that Mr. Reagan had managed to go, I think, largely under the guidance of George Shultz, from a point where he was throwing the Soviet Union on the ash heap of history and calling it an evil empire, to the point where he was willing to sit down and at one point in 1988 even stand in Red Square with Mikhail Gorbachev essentially kissing babies as if politics were all the same, whether it was under the hammer and sickle or under the stars and stripes.
I remember that image too, Ralph. The worst episode of his administration, perhaps Iran-Contra?
Well, certainly in terms of his understanding of the implications of his own foreign policy, the Iran-Contra episode was the worst. Here was a case where Mr. Reagan had repeatedly told both the American people and the world community that the United States would not negotiate with terrorists. Those were his words. We will not negotiate with terrorists. And then to discover that one of his top aides, along with two other officials from the White House, had flown to Iran with a plane full in its belly of weapons being sold to Iran, carrying a key, a cake baked in the shape of a key, and carrying a Bible to Tehran, in an effort to get the Iranians to stop supporting the taking of American hostages in Lebanon, and then discovering, even after that, that the money from the purchase of those weapons by Iran was being shuffled to a completely unrelated U.S. foreign policy initiative in Nicaragua, where the U.S. was supporting rebels who were trying to unseat the communist government of Nicaragua. That was the Iran-Contra affair. Mr. Reagan at first denied that it happened. Then he denied that he understood what was happening and finally admitted that, yes, well, even though he didn't want to believe it, he had in fact traded weapons for hostages with a nation that he had called a terrorist nation. That was definitely a low point in his international policy.
Yeah. Ralph, I'm going to ask you to stand by. We're going to move on and chat with someone else for the moment. But I want to come back to you, if I can ask you to indulge us. Ralph Begleiter. Thank you so much, Ralph Dalton.
All right, well, we just want to bring our viewers up to date and remind you now that the hearse carrying the casket of Ronald Reagan is making its way to Andrews Air Force Base. And we see a shot of the plane there on the tarmac. Now, once the motorcade gets to Air Force Andrews Base, the casket is going to be loaded onto, it's going to be moved onto the plane, and the body of the former U.S. president will be taken back to California for a private sunset funeral tonight at the Reagan Presidential Library. And we're seeing onlookers there lining the streets of Washington, D.C., people paying their respects, both at the state funeral, which we saw earlier on, and scores of people lining up outside in Washington, D.C. And, of course, the casket of Ronald Reagan will be leaving Washington, D.C. for the last time.
Nancy und Ronald Reagan waren so aufeinander eingespielt, liebten einander so sehr, dass in ihrem Leben eigentlich niemand anderes Platz hatte, noch nicht einmal ihre Kinder. Ich war als Kind oft frustriert. Ich habe meine Eltern, während ich aufwuchs, kaum gesehen. Sie haben mich auf ein Internat gesteckt. Michael Reagan ist der Sohn aus der ersten Ehe von Ronald Reagan mit der Schauspielerin Jane Wyman. Ihre älteste Tochter Maureen ähnelte sehr der Mutter, ging jedoch wie ihr Vater in die Politik, allerdings ohne je Erfolg zu haben. Sie starb an Krebs. Maureen stand ihrem Vater sehr nah und hatte auch ein gutes Verhältnis zu ihrer Stiefmutter, aber nicht zu ihrem Bruder. Ronald Reagan und Jane Wyman hatten Michael adoptiert. Während der Präsidentschaft seines Vaters kam er nur selten ins Weiße Haus. Die Enkeltochter sah der verstorbene Präsident zum ersten Mal, als sie anderthalb Jahre alt war. Wissen Sie, ich habe meinen Vater nie vermisst, er hat mich nie umarmt, er hat mir nie gesagt, dass er mich liebt. Aber eines Tages bin ich aufgewacht, habe mich gefragt, wann habe ich ihm das letzte Mal gesagt, dass ich ihn liebe? Michael Reagan lernte dies zu tun und überwand seinen Ärger. Damit begann seine Karriere als Sprecher beim Radio.
Yeah. We're back, everybody.
Patty Davis, die zweite Tochter von Ronald Reagan, war manchmal mit ihrem Vater in Werbefilmen zu sehen. Später schrieb sie dann ein Buch über ihre schwierige Kindheit. Ich war geprägt von emotionaler, physischer, überhaupt allgemein von Ablehnung. Sie heiratete, wurde geschieden, ließ sich für den Playboy fotografieren, hatte wenig Kontakt zu den Eltern. Das änderte sich, als ihr Vater an Alzheimer erkrankte. Heute lebt sie in Los Angeles, schreibt für Zeitungen und Magazine. So wie Patty hatte auch ihr jüngerer Bruder Ron eine wechselhafte Karriere. Er war Tänzer, später Schauspieler. Und er schockierte viele mit seinen Anti-AIDS-Kampagnen.
This is a condom.
Viel später arbeitete er beim Fernsehen und vor einigen Jahren war er zu Gast bei Larry King und sprach über seinen Vater.
The word that comes to mind for me is gentleman.
Maureen setzte sich bis zu ihrem Tod für Alzheimer-Kranke ein, aber es ist nicht der von Alzheimer gezeichnete Ronald Reagan, an den man sich erinnern wird, sondern der Präsident und der Mann, der eigentlich nur seine Frau Nancy liebte.
Andrews, when Mr. Reagan was in office, the Air Force One plane was a lot smaller than that. It was during his administration, for the first time in decades, that the United States government and Congress agreed to spend the money to build an aircraft capable of carrying not only the president, of course, but also the much larger retinue of staff and media that came to be important in the television age for covering a president. So the Air Force Ones that you now see flying the American presidents around came into being at the very, very end of the Reagan administration. I think he was the first to fly the first 747 Air Force One, and of course he'll be flying one of those home now to California.
All right, Ralph, thanks very much. We've got plenty more to talk about with all of our guests, so Ralph, stay with us, and we're going to come back and pick this up a little later on. And we just want to remind our viewers that we are looking at live pictures of Air Force Andrews Base, the plane there on the tarmac that will carry the casket of Ronald Reagan back to California. And we're gonna, Michael and I will be back in just a moment. We're gonna take a very quick break. Don't go away.
When asked, how did your visit go with Bishop Tutu? He replied, so-so.
With laughter and tears, friends and family pay tribute to an American political icon.
And as the body of Ronald Reagan is laid to rest, people around the world mourn the death of an American cultural icon, musician Ray Charles. It is 2 p.m. in Washington, 2 a.m. in Hong Kong. Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm Daljit Dhaliwal.
And I'm Michael Holmes. Welcome to this special edition of Your World Today. And you are watching live pictures there from the Andrews Air Force Base in Maryland, just outside Washington, D.C. A military honor guard will place the body of the late U.S. President Ronald Reagan on a plane bound for California in just a few minutes. The casket will be removed from the hearse, and an Air Force band will play the song Going Home before the plane departs.
Now, this follows a state funeral that ended about an hour or so ago in the nation's capital, and we will bring you the departure ceremony at Andrews Air Force Base live as it happens.
Old Man River, that Old Man River.
Tributes from the music world for singer Ray Charles, who died on Thursday at the age of 73 at his home in Beverly Hills from complications from liver disease. The last concert was nearly a year ago, but Charles had recently finished an album of duets. Among the blues singer's breakthroughs, mixing the musical genres of gospel and R&B, raising both eyebrows and a richness of American music in the process.
To California for a private sunset burial at his presidential library. That is just north of Los Angeles. We can tell you, as we look at the pictures coming from the Andrews Air Force Base, that the hearse has arrived at the Air Force Base and ceremonies will soon begin there. U.S. Air Force plane, Air Force One, one of several Air Force Ones, will be used to take the body back to California. What we're expecting here is that the hearse will pull up onto the tarmac there. and the casket will be removed from the hearse. Honours will be rendered. There'll be a 21-gun salute. The Air Force Band is expected to play Going Home, and then the casket will be carried between ranks of honorary pallbearers and what's called the honour cordon, and you can see there people lining up waiting to witness the departure of the body of the 40th President of the United States to his home state, where he will be buried at the presidential library that bears his name. I want to bring in Ralph Begleiter once again, former CNN World Affairs correspondent, a man who has spent many years travelling the world and covering the foreign policy of Ronald Reagan. Ralph, appreciate you sticking around. I should say that Ralph is also a professor of communication and distinguished journalist in residence at the University of Delaware in Newark. Ralph, we talked earlier about perhaps the low point for Ronald Reagan's foreign policy, and that was the Iran-Contra affair. Another issue that is related, of course, was all that was going on in Beirut, Lebanon, at the time. I think you and certainly I had friends who were hostages in Beirut at that time. And what did all of that do to the presidency? What was the mark of that?
Well, that was a very interesting time for Mr. Reagan, because most of that occurred in his first term. The Iran-Contra matter really didn't come to light until into his second term, but in the first term, in the first couple of years, the Middle East plagued Mr. Reagan in a way that must have been very difficult for him to deal with, because remember that he took office literally at the moment he took office in January of 1980. The American hostages from the U.S. Embassy in Iran were released, and Mr. Reagan had made throughout his campaign and then very early on after becoming president numerous public pledges not to deal with terrorists, not to cut and run, not to negotiate in any way with those who were terrorizing the United States. And by the way, parenthetically, for Americans today who think terrorism began with 2001, September 11th, obviously Mr. Reagan confronted it much earlier than that. But in 1982, when the Israelis invaded Lebanon, Mr. Reagan agreed to send some Marines to Lebanon to try to broker the changes and broker a ceasefire and try to calm things down in that area, particularly also to try to get the Palestine Liberation Organization out of Beirut, which is where it was at the time. And so Mr. Reagan sent Marines into Lebanon at the same time as he was saying, we're not going to negotiate with terrorists and United States will never cut and run. He always talked about how the United States would stand tall and so on. In April of 1983, not long after the Israeli invasion, the U.S. Embassy in Beirut was car bombed, and it was really the first incident of its kind. We've seen many car bombs since then, but that was the moment at which that technique by terrorists became a worldwide phenomenon. The embassy was car bombed. People lost their lives. The United States was shaken by that. Mr. Reagan was shaken by it, but he kept the Marines there until October 1983, when terrorists in Lebanon car bombed the U.S. Marine barracks right near the Beirut airport, killing 241 Marines. And it was within a few months after that incident that Mr. Reagan ordered the American troops out of Lebanon. And that must have been a difficult decision for him to take, because his public rhetoric was all in the direction of not turning tail, not cutting and running, standing up to terrorism, and yet he made the decision to pull the United States out. And in some respects, I think it was that decision that that fostered the subsequent taking of American hostages in Lebanon. And as you said, both of us have had friends there and colleagues in the business who and in government who were held hostage, some of whom died in Lebanon. And Mr. Reagan had to confront that, and that ultimately led to his attempt to deal with the Iranian government, which was believed to have supported those who were anti-American in Lebanon. So that was a very, very difficult period for him, I'm sure.
Yeah, and you touched on this too. There are those who say that as part of the sometimes fuzziness of his foreign policy, he did very little about the Israeli-Palestinian question, as many argue George Bush has not done in this administration. What was the impact of his action or inaction on that issue?
Well, he did propose the Reagan plan. There was a Reagan plan for the Middle East, which was proposed in his second term. And George Shultz, toward the very end of the Reagan second term, I think it was as late as 1988, made a series of diplomatic visits to the region in an attempt to get some negotiations going. It was an unsuccessful attempt. There was one really notable decision that was taken during the Reagan administration at the very, very end, as after the election had been held in the United States, Mr. Reagan was a lame duck, and in December of 1988, the United States turned on a dime an old policy which had been not to even talk with, much less engage in negotiations with, the Palestine Liberation Organization. December of 88, the administration announced in Washington that it would open a dialogue with the PLO. And that was an important breakthrough, as many in the Middle East realize, of course, it's going to be hard. Let's put it this way, it's hard for us today to imagine how you could ever possibly think of achieving a settlement in the Middle East without negotiating with the Palestinian representatives. And so that was an important contribution. The result of it did not occur, of course, during the Reagan administration. Mr. Reagan was out of office in early 1989 after the inauguration of George Bush Sr. And it was in that administration that the dialogue with the PLO eventually flourished into a full-scale series of negotiations that followed the Gulf War 1991, led to the Madrid Peace Conference in 1991, and a series of important breakthroughs between Palestinians and Israelis, and among the Israelis and other Arab countries as well.
Yeah. Just explain to viewers what's happening here. This is live pictures from the Andrews Air Force Base, and on time, virtually to the minute, the casket carrying Ronald Reagan arriving at the Air Force Base. It will be put on the aircraft, and after some ceremony will be sent to California to be interred. Yes, go ahead, Ralph.
Just a word on that. You mentioned the carefully timed piece. That's another piece of the Reagan legacy. During the 1980s, the Reagan administration became known for its presidential stagecraft. In fact, other countries, including Great Britain, many others in Europe, and some in other parts of the world, learned from the Reagan administration how to stage public events and presidential or leadership events in such a way that they will be carried in the news media and especially on television in the most flattering way for the leader in question. It was Michael Deaver and President Reagan himself who, and Mrs. Reagan, who have planned this funeral from the day Mr. Reagan left office right up until today. It is no surprise to those of us who covered the administration in the 1980s that Mr. Reagan's final farewell is as well crafted for the news media as any event he held during his presidency.
Yeah, really, really good point. Yeah, yeah. Some say he was planning this funeral, at least asking some people to speak at it as early as his first days in office. Ralph, please stand by, enjoying your insights. Daljit, you're going to carry on from here for a second.
Yeah, we're going to pick up the discussion in a moment with a couple of guests who've been talking to earlier on, but just a quick reminder to our viewers that we are expecting the casket to be moved onto the plane. There it is, sitting there on the tarmac. We are expecting a 21-gun salute, and we're also expecting the Air Force Band to play Going Home. Now, when that happens, we will bring it to you, and we promise to be quiet at that point for you. But let me bring in two other guests who've been talking to us. Mary Surati of Cambridge University, she teaches international studies, and presidential author William Doyle. William, let's start with you. How will history remember Ronald Reagan, in your view?
Well, I hope they'll remember perhaps his greatest achievement. When he took office, the world lived in a state of literal terror on a daily basis over the possibility of tens of thousands of Soviet and American nuclear weapons flying into the air and destroying entire cities, and tens of millions of fatalities within a matter of one or two hours. That was a daily reality for all the people of the world. And Ronald Reagan thought that was completely insane. He made it his chief mission in the Oval Office to try to get out of the state of mutual assured destruction, which is unbelievable for us really to think about today, and to try to navigate a way through that. And he completely achieved that. The weapons were taken off their alerts. The superpower relationship was transformed. And the magnitude of that achievement, I'm not sure we all fully appreciate today, but it was his mission and he achieved it.
Mary, what about your thoughts? How do you think that history is going to remember Ronald Reagan?
Well, evaluations of presidents change over time. When Truman left office, he was, of course, seen as a bit of a failure, and now we have dramatically revised our opinion of him upwards. And in many senses, I think President Reagan will be remembered as completing the work that Truman and Eisenhower started. You'll see a continuous arc from the policies of containment early in the Cold War through detente, then to Reagan's approach. Reagan, I think what he brought to it was a belief that you could actually bring the Cold War to an end, that it wasn't a permanent condition. And that, by the later decades of the Cold War, was actually radically new thinking. A lot of politicians had gotten used to thinking of it as the status quo. But I also think, obviously, today is the funeral. It is appropriate that today we pay our respects to President Reagan. His family is grieving. I think in the longer run, the audit of history will be more critical than some of the coverage we're seeing on the news and the images of this week. There'll be more focus on the controversies of his presidency in Central America, his lack of a domestic response to AIDS. There'll be questions about the budget deficits. There's a sense, this actually was expressed in Paul O'Neill's book. Paul O'Neill, of course, was the Treasury Secretary to this President Bush, who left office and has written a book called The Price of Loyalty. And in The Price of Loyalty, he says he was shocked to hear from the lips of Dick Cheney saying, Reagan proved deficits don't matter. So that could be a very ambivalent legacy. But as I said, I think that's something that historians will talk about in the future. As I said, today the focus is obviously on the positive side of his legacy.
If I could just add to that, whenever a politician is tempted to smear his or her opponent or to get into a vicious personal attack, I hope they might pause for a minute and think, what would Ronald Reagan do? Because his whole style was kind of a gold standard politically in terms of just being a class act and taking the inspirational road rather than the vicious politics that has become a daily event really here in America. I think it's something we can all learn from.
You know, actually, if I could just jump back in, sorry.
Yes, I just wanted to remind our viewers that we are looking at live pictures of Andrews Air Force Base as the body of Ronald Reagan is going to be loaded on, is going to be moved onto a plane in a few moments. And we just want to take a just pause for a moment and listen in here.
And we welcome viewers to CNN. I'm Becky Anderson in London. And we're watching live pictures from Andrews Air Force Base as those leaving with the coffin of Ronald Reagan back to California enter the plane, which will be leaving shortly from the Air Force Base, the coffin which was taken by motorcade to the airport, will fly to California, where it will once again be met by motorcade, and the coffin will be driven to the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library in Simi Valley, north of Los Angeles, for about 6 o'clock local time. And there'll be a private sunset ceremony on a hill overlooking the Pacific Ocean, attended by some 700 or so family and friends, we're told, including Hollywood actors Charlton Heston and Kirk Douglas, amongst others. And those traveling with the family just entering the plane, which will, as I say, take off shortly for California. I'm joined in Newark and in New York this evening by three guests, and we thank them. I'll start, if you will, with Mary Sorote, Cambridge University lecturer, joining us from New York. Mary, your thoughts?
I was actually very moved to see Margaret Thatcher climbing the stairs just now. Margaret Thatcher, of course, three-term Prime Minister of Great Britain and great friend of Ronald Reagan. Obviously, they were ideological compatriots, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be friends. Witness, of course, today, George Bush and Jacques Chirac are both on the right politically, but that doesn't mean that they're friends. So it really was a happy meeting of the minds, cooperation between Reagan and Thatcher. She always appreciated his strong backing for the Falklands War, and he appreciated her frank advice. She actually was the person who convinced him that Gorbachev was a man to take seriously, and her success in doing so obviously had great consequences for the shape of the world in which we now live. There's also a funny anecdote we were just discussing here watching the footage. Margaret Thatcher could be very frank with President Reagan, and when he described to her his Star Wars missile plan, the Strategic Defense Initiative SHIELD, the precursor of modern missile defense, she basically responded, I'm a chemist by training, I know it won't work. And after it was pointed out to her that there might be tens or even hundreds of millions of dollars of work for British voters in it, she suddenly said, there might be something in it. So a very interesting partnership, multi-layered, but a very, very strong friendship. And obviously, as shown by the fact that she made sure, even though she was in failing health, that she made it possible that she recorded her eulogy in advance.
A day, Ralph, for the family and gathered dignitaries, and many tributes today. Ronald Reagan hailed as a kind and modest soul who saw the best in America and a great liberator who helped to defeat communism. Ralph.
Becky, Mary's comment is very interesting. Ronald Reagan was a man who had the vision thing down. George Bush Sr. was criticized for not having the vision thing. But Mr. Reagan was someone who had the vision. He understood that the strategic missile defense Star Wars system would be something that would frighten the Soviet Union, and he used it that way. He never really bothered very much with the details, and it didn't matter to him, I think, whether it really would work or not. He imagined that it would, and of course it's still not in operation today. But the point is that he was able to use it to good strategic value during those last years of the Cold War. In terms of liberation, well, just a comment about the takeoff we're about to see. The last time Washington bade farewell to President Reagan was just after he left office, when his helicopter took off from the White House in Washington and made a ceremonial circle around the Washington Monument, overlooking the U.S. Capitol building and all the splendid scenes of the nation's capital, and then took off also at that time for California. I don't know whether anything of that sort is planned. Obviously, it's a little more difficult to do with a 747 than it is in a helicopter, but it would not surprise me either to see some kind of ceremonial farewell from the air at the time Mr. Reagan's plane takes off, this time for the last flight to California. You talked about liberation, which reminded me momentarily about the South African government, and Mr. Reagan's administration played a very key role in the end of apartheid in South Africa. It was toward the end of his second term when Mr. Reagan stuck to his guns and stuck to his principle of his friends in the apartheid regime in South Africa, and refused to go along with members of the U.S. Congress and many others around the world who were urging the United States to give up on apartheid and to urge the white regime in South Africa to move toward democracy. Well, toward the very end of the administration in the United States, Mr. Reagan made that decision, and eventually it fell to Secretary of State James Baker to go to South Africa to pass the message in the next term of presidency. And then that message was, the jig is up, the United States is no longer backing the apartheid regime. But that occurred toward the end of the Reagan administration.
And as we watch the plane taxiing for takeoff, remind ourselves that we're watching live pictures from Andrews Air Force Base as Ronald Reagan's coffin, his family and friends leave for California. Friday's funeral and burial cap, a week of ceremonies that began on Monday, of course, with a private ceremony for his family at the Reagan Library. The former president's body lay in a closed casket in the library's main lobby for about 30 hours of public visitation. Then the coffin was flown from California to Washington on Wednesday, where the body lay in state throughout Thursday in the Capitol Rotunda. And the state funeral, the first since that of former President Lyndon Johnson in 1973. Just as we await the takeoff of the plane, very briefly, we're also joined from New York by William Dole. William, the Economist magazine today headlining and giving up its front page and leader to a picture of Ronald Reagan, and just the words, the man who beat communism. They remind their readers that not everything was great about his presidency. They say Ronald Reagan was fond of a nap and no intellectual. Oddly enough, though, they say he had what it took.
Well, he had a kind of mystical belief in a very narrow list of very strong values. And what strikes me now as we watch the plane take off is that his final destination, his library in California, which he helped conceive of and build, really, and supervise the building of, is a perfect metaphor for Ronald Reagan. It's perched on a beautiful hill overlooking the Pacific and a rolling series of hills down to the shore. And in the morning, the fog comes in almost every morning off the Pacific, and then it burns off, and it lives in a kind of a golden sunshine, eternal sunshine, in this beautiful wine country of in the foothills of California. And that's where he'll be now. And I used to do research at the Reagan Library and go out by that burial site sometimes and watch the sunset. And it's one of the most beautiful sites in America, really. And I can't think of a more perfect place for Ronald Reagan.
And that the voice of William Doyle as we watch the takeoff of the 747 bearing the coffin of Ronald Reagan. Those last pictures from Andrews Air Force Base as the plane bearing the coffin of Ronald Reagan, his family and friends, departs en route for California.
Amazing grace. Es war ein bewegender und würdevoller Abschied in der Nationalen Kathedrale von Washington. God saved our alles war minutiös geplant. Ein ausgeklügeltes Protokoll bestimmt jedes kleinste Detail eines solchen Staatsaktes. Selbst das Arrangement der Blumen und die Sitzordnung der Gäste. Alle noch lebenden amerikanischen Präsidenten erwiesen Ronald Reagan die letzte Ehre. Ebenso zahlreiche Staats- und Regierungschefs aus dem Ausland, darunter Bundeskanzler Schröder und der britische Premierminister Blair. Auch politische Weggefährten des großen Kommunikators waren gekommen. Mikhail Gorbatschow, Reagans ehemaliger Kontrahent im Kalten Krieg, der später zum Freund wurde, und Margaret Thatcher. Die ehemalige britische Premierministerin, die nach mehreren Schlaganfällen keine öffentlichen Reden mehr hält, hatte die Botschaft vorher aufgezeichnet. Ich habe einen lieben Freund verloren. Ronald Reagan war so fröhlich und erfrischend. Man konnte darüber leicht vergessen, welch schwierige historische Aufgabe er sich stellte. Präsident George Herbert Walker Bush, der Reagan lange als Vizepräsident diente, erinnerte vor allem auch an den Witz und den Humor des Verstorbenen. Als er gefragt wurde, wie denn das Treffen mit Bischof Tutu war, sagte er nur so-so.
When asked how did your visit go with Bishop Tutu, he replied so-so.
Typisch, einfach wunderbar.
It was typical, it was wonderful.
Sein Sohn, der jetzige Präsident, beschrieb Reagan als einen Mann, der ständig an das Gute im Menschen glaubte, und er erinnerte an seine lange, schwere Krankheit. Schon vor 10 Jahren hat sich Ronald Reagan von uns verabschiedet, aber es ist trotzdem sehr schwer, ihn jetzt gehen zu lassen. Er gehört nun der Geschichte an, aber uns allen wäre es lieber, er wäre weiter bei uns.
But we preferred it when he belonged to us.
Nach der bewegenden Zeremonie in der Nationalen Kathedrale wurde der Sarg mit dem verstorbenen Präsidenten zur Andrews Air Force Base gebracht. An Bord einer Präsidentenmaschine wird er nach Kalifornien überführt. Bei Sonnenuntergang wird Ronald Reagan im engsten Freundes- und Familienkreis in seiner Heimat beigesetzt.
Former U.S. President Ronald Reagan was honored today in a funeral ceremony attended by his wife Nancy, his 3 children, as well as friends and international dignitaries. Let's have a look back now at the state funeral held in Washington National Cathedral.
With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother Ronald for burial. Let us pray with confidence to God, the giver of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Faithful life, King of his time. was blind, but now I see.
To come here to the Reagan Library to say one final goodbye. Right now, the president's body is aboard one of the aircraft known as Air Force One. When a sitting president is aboard, today it is not called Air Force One. This aircraft designated by its tail number instead, 28,000. It is designated SAM 28,000, Special Air Mission 28,000. Right now, the president in the casket with family members headed right now to Point Magoo in Ventura County. From there, the president will be coming here via motorcade on a published route so that it's expected that thousands of people will line the motorcade route to say their final goodbyes as well. Once here, the Reagan family will be joined by people from various parts of President Reagan's life, from his political life, his personal life, from his Hollywood years. Some of the names we are expecting include Margaret Thatcher, California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, hockey great Wayne Gretzky, and actor Tom Selleck. The Reagan children are expected to provide remembrances, the surviving children Ron, Patty, and Michael. The military will provide a 21-gun salute, as well as a flyover of fighter jets from Lemoore Naval Air Station. There will be music, including a solo bagpiper who will play Amazing Grace as the casket is carried to the final burial site. The burial site here at the library is at a monument here that is made of limestone. In the limestone paving is where the president's casket will find its final resting place. That will take place outside of the view of cameras, and then on Monday the public will be invited to come back here to the Reagan Library. Becky.
Frank, this is a man who personified the Hollywood dream. I mean, his life effectively was like a film script. Effectively, you couldn't make it up. How do Californians feel about Ronnie Reagan? Is there a sense that they are proprietary about their ex-former governor?
Interesting. He is considered a favorite son in some ways among some people here in California. He was the governor of California for a period. He was the president of the Screen Actors Guild. But as you know, his hometown is Illinois, so he is claimed by both places. Having said that, California is a very large state, 35 million people, and not everyone loved Governor Reagan when he was here, President Reagan later. Still, there is a sense of propriety in the sense that people do feel a sense of ownership of this person, and the fact that he has chosen Simi Valley, the heart of what many people consider Reagan country, it gives the people here a sense that this favorite son is returning to his home state of California. And as I said, the public will have an opportunity to come back here starting on Monday.
We have just watched as the coffin carrying the body of former U.S. President Ronald Reagan has been moved into the back of the hearse that will take him through the streets of the U.S. state of California towards his presidential library, where he will be laid to rest. That ceremony, if you're just joining us, is due to begin shortly. In about 15 minutes from now, the motorcade, once everyone sits here at the site, the motorcade will depart carrying the casket, which you see there, as well as former President Reagan's widow, Nancy Reagan, and members of her family and some of the dignitaries who were also on that plane. They will be headed to the site near the presidential library, where friends and family are already gathering for a sunset ceremony, a private sunset ceremony that will take place there. The Reverend Michael Venning will be performing the invocation there, and a series of ceremonies is planned. Once again, for viewers who may be just joining us, the body of former U.S. President Ronald Reagan has made its way from Andrews Air Force Base on the East Coast all the way to the West Coast to the home state of the former president and the place where he will be laid to rest near the site of his presidential library, the U.S. state of California, where there is great affection for the former U.S. president, both for his political role in that state and for his role in the entertainment and film industry over the years.
Not a good place to stand.
You see a crowd of well-wishers has already gathered at the airport. Friends and family have gathered at the burial site for the upcoming ceremony. CNN will bring you live coverage of that ceremony as well. That motorcade that is just preparing to leave the airport tarmac now is going to take about 45 minutes to get to the presidential library and the burial site. The former British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher was one of the world leaders, the many world leaders who attended ceremonies earlier in Washington honoring the former U.S. president. She stepped off the plane as well. We just got a brief glimpse of her being escorted off the plane because of her health concerns and health issues. Her tribute to Mr. Reagan was done by videotape. She praised him for his economic policies and for standing against the Soviet Union, calling him one of the world's great leaders. The former Canadian Prime Minister, Brian Mulroney, also paid tribute, talking about his personal friendship with President Reagan. Even though that friendship cost him politically at home at the time, many Canadians believing that the former Prime Minister was too close to the U.S. President in terms of his policies, yet still the former Prime Minister paying tribute to his former colleague, saying that he possessed a rare and prized gift called leadership. And one of the most moving eulogies came from former President Bush, who of course served with former President Ronald Reagan, and said that Reagan personified the American spirit in his view, and his voice breaking with emotion, he said that he never learned more from anyone in public service than he learned from the former U.S. President Ronald Reagan. A large crowd of well-wishers has gathered along the way, along the pathway that has been set out for this motorcade to carry the coffin and Reagan family members to the presidential library in Simi Valley, where the burial will take place. The procession, the motorcade procession, expected to take approximately 45 minutes. You see a good shot there of the crowd, a rather large group, a quiet group right now, waving flags. They cheered a little bit as the plane touched down, but then grew quiet as Nancy Reagan and other dignitaries stepped off the plane. As that motorcade carries the former U.S. president to his burial site, we want to take you back a little bit earlier as world leaders past and present honored Reagan at his funeral service in Washington. CNN's Bruce Morton has our report.
Ronald Reagan left the Capitol for the last time. And at the National Cathedral, Washington gathered to mourn. American dignitaries, heads of states, every living U.S. ex-president. As president, Reagan often called America a city on a hill. In a reading at the service, Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, a Reagan nominee, quoted John Winthrop in a sermon he preached in 1630 on his way from England to the Massachusetts Bay Colony.
For we must consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us.
The Reverend John Danforth, a former senator from Missouri, talked of it too.
The Winthrop message became the Reagan message. It rang of optimism, and we longed to hear it, especially after the dark years of Vietnam and Watergate. It was a vision with policy implications. America could not hide its light under a bushel.
There were four eulogies, the first from former British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, who was at the service but recorded her thoughts on videotape.
He sought to mend America's wounded spirit, to restore the strength of the free world, and to free the slaves of communism. These were causes hard to accomplish and heavy with risk, yet they were pursued with almost a lightness of spirit. For Ronald Reagan also embodied another great cause, what Arnold Bennett once called the great cause of cheering us all up.
Many remembered his sense of humor, a one-liner it seemed, for all occasions. Former Canadian Prime Minister Brian Mulroney recalled waiting with Reagan for their wives after a summit meeting.
When their car drove in a moment later, out stepped Nancy and Mila, looking like $1 million. And as they headed towards us, President Reagan beamed. He threw his arm around my shoulder, and he said with a grin, "You know, Brian, for two Irishmen, we sure married up."
Reagan's vice president, who will turn 80 tomorrow, acknowledged a debt.
As his vice president for 8 years, I learned more from Ronald Reagan than from anyone I encountered in all my years of public life. I learned kindness. We all did. I also learned courage. The nation did.
The president stressed the religious faith he shares with Reagan.
In his last years, he saw through a glass darkly. Now he sees his Savior face to face. And we look for that fine day when we will see him again. All weariness gone, clear of mind, strong and sure and smiling again, and the sorrow of this parting gone forever.
They talked of his humor, his grace. He argued politics hard, but never meanly. The rancorous, nonstop partisanship of today's Washington was not in his nature. So Democrats and Republicans mourned and shared stories, and Ronald Reagan left the city for the last time. Headed back to the California he loved. Bruce Morton, CNN, Washington.
You have been watching our coverage of the arrival of the body of former U.S. President Ronald Reagan to his home state of California, where his burial service will take place just a short time from now, and CNN will bring you live coverage. And a reminder that we will continue our coverage here of the arrival of former U.S. President Ronald Reagan's body to his home state of California. A live look there at the motorcade that is carrying his body. It was removed, taken off the plane that carried it from Washington just a short time ago. It was taken off that plane and loaded into the motorcade along with members of his family. They are taking the drive now to the area near the presidential library where the final burial ceremony will take place. Crowds of people have been gathering along the street, and people also for several hours have been gathering at the presidential library preparing for the ceremony that will take place in what really is a final farewell to the former U.S. president before he is laid to rest. Family members are there, dignitaries, people from the entertainment industry as well, Mickey Rooney, Pat Sajak, who is the host of a popular entertainment program in the United States, hockey great Wayne Gretzky, all people who the Reagan family, who Nancy Reagan and former President Ronald Reagan counted among their friends. The ceremony atop the hill near the presidential library is a private ceremony for friends and families, although it will be televised, and we will bring you live coverage here on CNN when it gets underway in just a short time. We'll take a short break here on World News. Our coverage continues. Stay with us.
Global challenges, highlighting
a genius, a cornerstone of good, a great soul, and the voice of a lifetime. From his colleagues in the music world, tributes for singer Ray Charles. The man who mixed gospel and the blues died Thursday at 73 at his home in Beverly Hills. He died from complications from liver disease. CNN's Frederica Ritfield remembers the sounds and the emotions that made a career.
What y'all done?
Ray Charles's life was a rags-to-riches story told with lyrics and melodies liberally laced with soul. Born Ray Charles Robinson on September 23, 1930, to Aretha and Bailey Robinson in rural Albany, Georgia. The family was desperately poor. By the time he was 7 years old, glaucoma had robbed Charles of his sight. But before he went blind, he saw his little brother drown. Charles credits his mother with helping him overcome blindness and become independent.
She was watching me go blind, you know, she knew I was going to lose my sight. But her thing was, you still got that brain. You still can think, and there are two ways to do everything. You just got to figure out which one is good for you. That was the influence my mom had on me.
After his mother died, he left Florida State School for the Blind, where he learned to read Braille, play piano, and memorize music. Learned so well, he could compose and arrange melodies in his head. Charles hit the road as a struggling musician. It was about this time, though, that he picked up a drug habit, a habit he didn't kick until convicted of heroin and marijuana possession 20 years later.
He must know something.
Charles's path to greatness would lead him far from the South to Seattle, Washington. He became a minor celebrity on the local club scene, where he met an even younger musician, Quincy Jones. Their lives would be intertwined for decades.
We used to sit and dream as teenagers to say, man, we want to do this. We want to work with a symphony orchestra. We want to do movies. We want to do this. We want to play this music. And we got to do every dream that we dreamed about.
His first real taste of fame would come with the 1955 release of I've Got a Woman. It was the beginning chorus of Charles's indelible mark on the face of popular music. In 1960, Charles won his first Grammy for Georgia On My Mind. His rendition of the song would later become the state song of Georgia.
Oh, my Georgia.
The music of Ray Charles defined modern soul, brought jazz and R&B to the mainstream, helped country music gain worldwide acceptance, and along the way, many credited Charles with being instrumental in the invention of rock and roll.
I am a singer that sings country music, that sings the blues, or that sings jazz, or that sings love song. I'm a singer that, you know, in other words, I'm a utility person. You know, I play whatever position you want to put me in.
Whether he was with a major symphony or his own band, Charles became known for setting trends, not following them.
I think that's the great thing about what I do in my music. You can bend, I mean, you can change, as long as you stay within the context of the song itself so you don't lose the public. You can always do it 50,000 different ways, too. Huh?
His wide smile and dark glasses were even immortalized in claymation. His icon status caught the eye of Pepsi. In Charles, the soft drink giant found one of their most memorable pitchmen.
You got the right one, baby.
Already honorary chairman of the Rhythm and Blues Hall of Fame, in 1986, Charles became one of the original inductees into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Sweet America.
His rendition of America the Beautiful would set the 1984 Republican convention on fire.
I've been so many places in my life and time.
A Song for You brought Charles his 12th Grammy in 1994. The popular entertainer also knew the value of giving back. He lent his considerable talents to the song We Are the World, raising millions to feed the people starving in Africa.
I'm doing something that I love doing. In other words, I'm not doing a job because I have to eat, and so therefore I must work at something that I don't like, but it's a means to an end. What I do is like a hobby. It just turns out that people are nice enough to pay me for it.
His life was a lesson in triumph overcoming tragedy, and his audience, the whole world.
For me, my music is my existence. It's just like your breathing. Without your breathing, you're no longer here. Without my music, I feel I'm no longer here.
Frederica Whitfield, CNN reporting.
Now I'm singing my song for you.
And that is World News for now. I'm Colleen McEdwards at CNN Center. Please stay with us for our special coverage of the final ceremonies for former U.S. President Ronald Reagan. That coverage starts in a little less than a half an hour.
This is CNN. This is CNN.
Hello, I'm Bill Schneider in London. Welcome to CNN's International Correspondence, where we examine how the media are covering the big stories of the moment. We begin with the outpouring of grief over the death of former American President Ronald Reagan, the actor turned president, eulogized by his country and political leaders across the world.
Today, the final farewells to President Ronald Reagan.
Wall-to-wall coverage filled our screens and newspapers, reflecting on his life and detailing his death. But what of the controversy? What of his critics? And how will history judge his presidency? I'm joined now by two journalists who covered that presidency. Peter Riddle, columnist with the Times of London, who covered Ronald Reagan near the end of his presidency, and Godfrey Hodgson, journalist and author. He made a series for television about the life of Ronald Reagan and has a new book coming out on American politics, More Equal Than Others. Let me start with you, Peter. Do you believe the coverage has been excessive? Has it been balanced? Should it be balanced at a time like this?
There's always a tendency, particularly when someone dies at the age Ronald Reagan has and after such an awful disease as he's had for the last 10 years, to be reverential to an extent. But I think that it is also typically divided people between what you'd in America describe as conservatives and liberals. There's been a desire in the conservative press, like the Spectator magazine and the Telegraph, to eulogize him and say, one of the towering figures. And on the left, in The Guardian and in the New Statesman magazine, there's been more criticism. So, yes, there has been that. I think what's been interesting is there have been attempts, particularly in broadcasting, and in some papers, to try and assess him in a more detached way. I don't think it's necessarily been excessive, but because it's now some time since he was president, there has been an attempt to put him in perspective, and I think some of that's been quite good.
Yes, Godfrey, let me ask your opinion. From the point of view of a European or someone here in Britain, does this coverage seem excessive outside the United States?
Well, I don't know about excessive, but it certainly is reverential. That word of Peter's is absolutely right. Because, after all, an American president is a head of state, is an iconic figure as well as being a political leader. And I think we got that. And I think this has been done with great dignity and style, if I may say so. It's rather like a royal occasion. And I think people were very fond of Ronald Reagan. I certainly was. I worked with him when I made a series about him, and he's just a very nice man. On the other hand, I think to compare him with the Founding Fathers is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Ronald Reagan was once asked towards the end of his presidency, do you think an actor is qualified to be president? And he said famously, I don't know how anyone who's not an actor could do this job. Do you think those skills were essential? I'll ask first, Godfrey.
Absolutely. I mean, I think he had tremendous media skills, which he'd acquired as an actor, but also as a radio reporter, and crucially, in the contract he had with GE, when he went around doing at factory gates just the kind of things that presidential candidates or any other politicians do. And I think at the level of technique, he was terrific. I think at the top level of big ideas, he had some big ideas. In the middle, he was pretty vague and sometimes pretty unreliable when it came to facts.
Mm-hmm. Presidents are often reevaluated after they leave office. Certainly Harry Truman was. His presidency has grown in stature. He was one of the least popular presidents ever. Peter, do you think history will reevaluate Reagan, and do you think it will be kind or harsh to him?
I think it'll be a balance, and I think that one of the problems is, and that's been shown in some of the coverage I've read on the internet and the American press this week, is that, of course, he's part of the current argument that current conservatives, after all, we're in the middle of a presidential election year, are using, perhaps abusing, the Reagan legacy as part of the current political arguments. So you can't get a detached view. I'm sure they will reevaluate him. I think there's a balance looking at his foreign legacy, which from a British perspective has its ups and downs, the evil empire, followed then by the talks with Gorbachev, Reykjavik, the Frank meetings, the opening up, and then Iran-Contra, which totally mystified people in Britain. You've got to remember that for people like Godfrey and myself who covered Reagan, we saw his personal charm, but for most people in Britain, he was a mysterious figure. We just couldn't understand him. The parallels here with George W. Bush, who's not understood here either. Yeah. But I think there will be a revaluation on the domestic side. Again, it's part of the current argument about tax cuts and deficits.
Yes. Let me ask you about the comparison you were just making with George W. Bush. How would you compare the image of Reagan in the world when he was president with the current image of George W. Bush?
I think George W. Bush's image is much, much less favorable. After all, apart from Lebanon, the bombing of Libya, Grenada, Ronald Reagan may have supplied arms to a lot of people, for example, in Central America and in Afghanistan. But he didn't start a major war, which George W. Bush has done. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the big difference. And why, certainly in the early years of the Reagan presidency, there were big protests in Europe over the sighting of cruise and Pershing missiles. It turned out to be absolutely vindicated later on. But at the time, there were big protests led by people like Gerhard Schroeder, now the German Chancellor. But the early hostility to Reagan turned to a more favorable image later on. The image of George W. Bush couldn't be more unfavorable in Europe and most countries.
Godfrey, what is your view? How would you compare Reagan's image and Bush's?
Well, I think that Ronald Reagan moved the center of gravity of American politics to the right, but he did it with a smile, not with a snarl. And I'm afraid that George W. Bush comes across, I mean, he's being a bit nicer now because he wants our help and our money, but in fact, to begin with, he was amazingly unpleasant towards the Europeans. And surprisingly, people don't like being spoken to in that way. The general idea was that we were to understand that we were old, weak, irrelevant. And of course, we didn't like that very much. And now, of course, he's trying to do nice, but it may be a little bit too late.
Thank you. Thank you, Godfrey. Thank you, Peter. I appreciate it. Up
coverage of the final farewell to U.S. President Ronald Reagan, to former U.S. President Ronald Reagan, who passed away on Saturday at the age of 93 from complications from Alzheimer's disease, which he had battled for about a decade. You are looking at live pictures now from the U.S. state of California, where he will be laid to rest, in the motorcade procession that is moving along the highway there from a Naval Air Force Base where the plane just recently touched down. The former president's casket was taken off the plane and put onto the hearse that you see leading the motorcade there, and is now en route to the area near the presidential library where a sunset ceremony will be taking place. You can see cars pulled off to the side. There are people outside of their cars. This is very typical of what has been going on, as well-wishers along the route of the motorcade are paying their final respects to the former U.S. President Ronald Reagan. The ceremony, the actual burial ceremony, will get going just a short time from now. Dignitaries, friends and family members, the governor of California, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and his wife, people from the film and entertainment industry, and the political world have all been arriving at the site of the burial for the service. Once again, you are watching live pictures of the funeral procession towards the burial place where the former U.S. President Ronald Reagan will be laid to rest just a short time from now. We now want to turn you over to our coverage by CNN's U.S. domestic network of the ceremonies. I'm Colleen McEdwards at CNN Center.
Very courageous. This is a wonderful example of a family and of the kind of relations between men and women, and of the role of a woman in the life of a political leader. Yesterday I had a meeting with her, and we had a very sincere and warm conversation about that time, and we have been in contact with Nancy Reagan these years. We've been in correspondence all these years.
Well, that's very nice to hear. Ed Meese, are you at all surprised by the outpouring this week?
Well, I think all of us have been very gratified by the extent. I know we all expected it, but I must say it's exceeded even my expectations of how the public would react. And I think what happened in California with, I understand, over 100,000 people lining up, people were still lined up here today when they had to cut off the viewing. And I think that this outpouring of affection and gratitude is just a tremendous thing for recognition of this great president.
If you're just joining us, we're in Simi Valley. I'm Larry King. This is kind of a special edition of Larry King Live. It is the coverage of the laying to rest of the 40th president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. That caravan, there you see the lead car, is approaching the Reagan Library here at Simi Valley, where 700 friends of the former president, the late president, and the first lady are gathered for this special service. Wolf Blitzer, were you, and I don't know if Paul is still with you, but were you surprised at the outpouring?
Yes, I was surprised. I was a week ago at this time, Larry, in Normandy, getting ready to cover the 60th anniversary of D-Day, And all of a sudden, of course, we began to get word early that Saturday morning, a week ago tomorrow, that Ronald Reagan may be in, it may be getting close to the end. And of course, we began to prepare for that development. But even when it happened around 1 p.m. Pacific time Saturday afternoon and 4 o'clock Eastern time in the afternoon, it was already late into the night in France, it did come as a significant, stunning development, even though, I guess with hindsight, none of us should have been all that surprised. I didn't really know what to anticipate in the days that followed, but I must say this week-long official period of mourning here in the United States and the way the outpouring of solidarity and support for Ronald Reagan, the expressions of friendship, not only, of course, by those who loved him, the Republicans and conservatives, but also by Democrats and liberals who have come out, and that demonstration was reflected, Larry. If you looked in the audience at the National Cathedral today, they were all there.
Well, Gary, I know military things run on time, but guess what?
They're running a little bit late.
That's they right. tell us about 12 minutes from now. It should have arrived now. So, Mr. Foster, how do we explain this?
We actually had a little time built in to allow the motorcade to slow down when he gets to some residential areas to let people pay their respects one last time. And so we're fully aware, and I think it'll still go off without a hitch once he gets up here.
I'm sure it will. Is that some sort of rule that Wolf mentioned, 20 miles an hour?
It will actually maybe slow down to as slow as 5 or 10 miles an hour once he gets into some residential areas here in a few blocks. But no, there's no rule.
Senator Dole, have you ever seen anything like this?
Not really. No, and I've been around for a while. But, you know, I would get up in the middle of the night and turn on C-SPAN. They were still passing through the Capitol, and it was really impressive. But, you know, everybody agrees that President Reagan was a great guy, a nice guy, but we also, he had a great record. We sometimes overlook the record, what he was able to achieve. We didn't win them all. I remember one time we'd had a big victory. He called and said, "What can I do for you?" I said, "Please call my mother. She's in the hospital." He said, "Give me her number." He made the call within 30 minutes.
Yeah.
That's the kind of guy.
Well said. Anyone who knew him knew he was that kind of guy. We were at a wedding once, Gary. I mean, I was having lunch with him and Nancy at the Bel Air Hotel. And that day, a couple was getting married. And he poked me in the elbow and he said, "Let's go over and take pictures with him." We walked over and we were suddenly in the wedding party.
You know, and it's a shame that because of the confines that he had when he was president and even governor to a certain extent, that he couldn't do a lot of that because he really enjoyed it. And once he left office and came back here to California, there's stories like that all the time. You know, he'd go to church and hang out for you know, half hour just greeting people and be seen on the golf course, and people would approach him and he'd tell stories and jokes, and he just, you know, I think relished actually being out of office so he could do quite a bit of that.
What are the plans, Gary, regarding the children speaking today? Will be the first time.
This will be the first time, and all three of them will speak. And quite honestly, it's going to. We have not been told what they will say or read. But this will be the first and only time that they will actually participate in any of the services.
President Gorbachev, is the late President Reagan a popular figure in Russia?
President Reagan popular in Russia сегодня?
Well,
certainly he is among those who are remembered. And they remember his visit to Moscow. They remember his behavior. They remember his remarks. President Reagan was initially considered as just a hawk, as just a person who is a fierce anti-communist and who had some kind of special hatred toward the Soviet Union. But time later showed that, well, indeed, there were things that he rejected that he could not accept, and he rejected those things that we ultimately rejected too. But he was a person who had a big heart, a person who had his values, and a person for whom the wish to do something, the wish to make a difference, the wish to support his friends, but in particular to support the entire nation, to support the mood of the entire nation. This was very, very typical of him. I saw that and I valued those qualities of President Reagan, and that's why we were able to get along fairly quickly, because we worked together not for too many years, but we were able to do a great deal together. You know, starting things of the kind that we started, starting the process of reducing nuclear weapons, of ending the arms race, it's difficult, it's hard. Hard work, but we were able to get along, we were able to speak candidly to each other. My opinion of his human qualities also is very high. He was a great president. He was a wonderful man. He was an extraordinary person.
This motorcade has slowed down considerably. I noticed they just got off at Lynn Road. Gary, will you give us the proximity of Lynn Road to where we are?
It's just about 5 or 10 miles from here, but it will take a while to come up because they're going to slow down, because as you can see, this is more of a residential area, and the crowds are, I don't know, 15 people deep, and so they're going to allow everybody to, as I said before, pay their respects. We actually have been advertising this route for quite a while for those who weren't able to either make it to the library or the U.S. Capitol to actually, you know, say goodbye one more time.
What do you think it is? Maybe this is for everyone. What do you think it is? We'll start with you, Gary. That brings people out to sit and wait and wait and wait to see a car go by.
Well, I would say, you know, it's a combination of you know, everything that everybody's been said. He touched people in so many different ways, whether it was his policies or striking a chord from you know, the less government and ending the Cold War, or his just unbelievable humility and warmness that he portrayed both in public, through just his appearances, but then also, as you said, in private. I just think he just did not have an enemy in the world.
Senator Dole, what do you think it is that people would come out just like this on a beautiful afternoon to stand on the street?
I think there are a lot of similarities between my hero, President Eisenhower, and Ronald Reagan. They had this big smile, and they had a lot of respect for different reasons from the American people, cut across party lines, ethnic lines, race. And there are parallels between President Kennedy and Ronald Reagan, whether it's cutting taxes or whether it's trying to reduce the bureaucracy. I think President Reagan knew precisely who he was, and the American people liked what they saw, and what you saw is what you got.
President Gorbachev, what do you think of the turnout and the events this week and people lining streets and over 100,000 coming to the Capitol and so many coming here to Simi Valley? What do you think of this, of the public's love for him?
Well, that just goes to show, to prove that I was right when I've been saying over these days, both in Russia and here, when I came here, that President Reagan certainly was someone who did a great deal for his own nation and for the world. And I think that people are paying tribute to this man who was thinking about people and who was doing a great deal for the people to make their lives better.
Peace was not controversial, right? I mean, there was a lot of people who disagreed strongly with Reagan policies.
Было немало людей, которые резко были против политики Рейгана, всё-таки это тоже факт.
That he was controversial in the sense that he had policies that some people disagreed with, but I think part of it was the fact that he could deal with people who disagreed without being disagreeable. And I know that's a cliche, but it certainly was true in his case. You remember Tip O'Neill, when
Tip was Speaker of the House of Representatives. There was a lot of differences of opinion on a number of subjects, from tax cuts to supporting the freedom fighters in Nicaragua. But as Ronald Reagan used to say, after 6 o'clock, we're friends. And so they would put aside the differences, they'd have a drink or two together and swap Irish stories, and that was Ronald Reagan.
As Wolf has put, Wolf, you pointed out that the liberals, Democrats have turned out in mass for this. Is this kind of a, they're not saying we feel sorry, we disagree with you, but they are saying we liked you, right?
Everybody is saying that. Everybody's saying they liked Ronald Reagan, they admired him, his optimism, his happiness, the sense that he was a politician. You could make a deal with him. All the Democrats recalling, yes, they disagreed with him on various policies, but he was a president of the United States that they respected, that they admired, that they could work with and get the job done. I wonder, while we're waiting, Larry, for this motorcade to make its way to the presidential library where you are, one quick question I've always been interested in asking Mikhail Gorbachev, if I could,
sure.
and ask him this, because I was there in the Soviet Union at the time. It was August 1991, after the Gulf War. There was a coup d'etat against him, against Gorbachev, in Moscow. It eventually turned out to be a failed coup d'etat. But I've always been interested in wondering, had that coup succeeded and he had been prevented from returning to office, if he were arrested, would the Cold War still be in business today? Would the Soviet Union still be in business today?
No, this coup could not succeed. It was a reckless adventure of those who were against the reforms, of those who were against perestroika, when they saw that their time was passing, that despite all difficulties, perestroika was moving forward. They did what they did one day before the signing of a new union treaty that would have created a different union, a decentralized, a democratic union. And I never hesitated when I was there, when I was isolated and locked, and when I was declared a sick person. I had no doubt that the coup would be defeated, and it was defeated.
Gary Foster, what was he like to work for?
Couldn't have had a better boss, especially for what I was doing, which was putting him out in public events where he could do what he did best, and that's communicate to people. He was a natural at it. We gave him settings, but he took it and ran with the ball. And behind the stage, he was the same man you saw in front. He was as much of a gentleman and polite and humble, as I said before, as he appeared to be in on the stage.
We're talking with Gary Foster, a close friend of the Reagan family, former White House staffer, and one of the key organizers of this event today, which will wind up soon here at the Reagan Library for the ceremonies and the laying to rest of the 40th president. Also with us is the former Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev, Senator Bob Dole, the former Senate Majority Leader, Ed Meese, the former Attorney General, and CNN anchor Wolf Blitzer. One of his closest political friends, former British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, paid respect to her good friend at today's National Cathedral Service. And although Lady Thatcher was in attendance, in fact, she flew on the plane with Nancy Reagan and is coming here tonight, her message was pre-recorded because of her own health problems. Listen.
As Prime Minister, I worked closely with Ronald Reagan for 8 of the most important years of all our lives. We talked regularly, both before and after his presidency, and I've had time and cause to reflect on what made him a great president. Ronald Reagan knew his own mind. He had firm principles, and I believe right ones. He expounded them clearly. He acted upon them decisively. When the world threw problems at the White House, he was not baffled or disorientated or overwhelmed. He knew almost instinctively what to do.
Senator Dole, how do you explain Thatcher-Reagan?
Well, it's a great friendship. Again, they trusted each other. They were friends. They had the same philosophy. They stuck to their guns. You know, she didn't wobble. Don't get wobbly. I remember she saying one time to President Bush, 41, and he didn't, of course. But I think it's just that, you know, both conservative, but had some flexibility, willing to compromise, civility. I mean, all these things that we've talked about.
Ed Meese, did he and Margaret Thatcher genuinely also, in addition to agreeing, like each other?
Yes, they certainly did. They had a lot of, they liked to joke together. They spent a lot of time together at these industrial summits when they attended, as well as on other visits. You remember, Margaret Thatcher was the had the first luncheon with from a foreign head of government after Ronald Reagan was inaugurated, because they had already met, they had already talked, and he was very fond of her, what she had done in England, but then also from that point on, their friendship developed. One of the things that was very important was they reinforced each other, because almost all the heads of state that attended those industrial summits at the start of their respective terms were socialists. And so they really carried the banner. And interestingly enough, when Ronald Reagan left office, almost all of the heads of state of the seven industrialized nations were center-right or free enterprise-oriented.
Gary Foster, we are being told now that this motorcade is about 15 minutes away. Is that what you read, for you know the area?
Yes, and in fact, I just got, I'm sitting here with my BlackBerry in my lap and just got a message from somebody in the motorcade who's actually worked for Ronald Reagan since 1979 when he was running for president, and has been virtually every rally and parade route that he ever took, and he said he has never seen anything like this before.
Really?
Elaborate. Yes. Yeah. Well, it was a very short message, but he said it was literally hundreds of thousands of people, and he's never seen such a sustained crowd for so long, and all even during his presidancy.
Wow. Wolf, what do you make of this?
Well, it's an amazing development. It underscores how special Ronald Reagan was to so many Americans, and it's not just Americans who remember him necessarily personally, because we've seen a lot of young people out there as well, Larry. You asked earlier why people do this, why they just go out on the street and want to get a glimpse of this hearse, of this motorcade, of these limousines that are moving forward. I think they sense that this is history unfolding right now, and it's one opportunity that they have. They'll be able to share with their children and their grandchildren. I remember when I was a young kid growing up in Buffalo, New York, Larry, I don't know if you went through an experience like this, but I remember once in the town of Tonawanda, a suburb I had heard with a bunch of my buddies, and I was in junior high, that Bobby Kennedy was running for the Senate in New York State and was going to be at some event. And we just decided we're going to stop playing baseball, we're going to go over there and get a glimpse. I didn't even know who Bobby Kennedy was, but I knew that he was the brother of President Kennedy, and I just wanted to see it. And you know what? All these years later, Larry, I still remember very vividly that glimpse of Bobby Kennedy when he was running for the Senate in New York State.
Yeah. Also, Gary, you would attest to this, how much President Reagan loved sweets, not just jelly beans. Because I had lunch with him once, and he had a hot fudge sundae for dessert, and he scraped the bowl.
Well, it was
he
funny.
He loved hot fudge sundae.
The only advantage of him traveling to events without Mrs. Reagan, because you knew he would much rather have him have her by his side at all times, was he got to eat the dessert when he went on the road. You know, she helped him watch his weight and eat a healthy diet, and very seldom had a dessert when she was around. But when he was on the road without her, that was his biggest treat, was being able to eat his dessert.
It can be safely said that Nancy eats like a bird.
Yes,
Nancy
does not have much of an appetite.
Not have a huge appetite. As we await this motorcade's arrival at the Presidential Library, again, running late because of unexpected crowds of people lining streets, causing the motorcade to slow down. They were due here to start this ceremony 17 minutes ago, and now they tell us they're about 10 to 12 minutes away. Let's show you some highlights of today's services at the National Cathedral.
Let us give thanks today for a life that achieved so much for all of God's children.
As his vice president for 8 years, I learned more from Ronald Reagan than from anyone I encountered in all my years of public life. I learned kindness. We all did. I also learned courage.
In the end, through his belief in our country and his love for our country, he became an enduring symbol of our country. May God bless Ronald Reagan and the country he loved.
Senator Dole, how did President Bush equip himself today, do you think?
Oh, I think he did very well. And you talk about parallels. There are a lot of President Bush, Ronald Reagan parallels, too, about the economy, about cutting taxes, about staying on message, about, you know, about sticking with your message. But I think it was the tone. It was just the right tone. Talking about President Reagan, not about himself, not about anything that might, you know, upset anybody in the political area. It was all about President Reagan. I thought it was just right.
Ed Meese mentioning Tip O'Neill as they did and Ronald Reagan and that unusual friendship and laughs and jokes. That doesn't seem to exist today, correct?
I think that there's much less civility today, positions have hardened, and I think that friendly spirit between two sides coming together after 6 o'clock is pretty hard to find.
It's tough. It's tough out there.
Yeah. Senator Dole?
I remember once President Reagan was kidding. He said, "Why should I remember all their names? Only about half of them vote with me anyway." You know, we were down there talking about who voted this way and that way. But, I don't know. I think this may help us a little bit. I think the American people are going to view this. They've viewed it for almost 5 days. And they may be asking their member of Congress, regardless of party, you know, why can't we have a little more civility? Why can't we get together? Why can't we, if necessary, compromise? You know, President Reagan said, "Give me 80% and I'll get to 20 next year." And I think that's the spirit that's going to be around for long. This is going to last for a while. This isn't going to disappear tomorrow morning. My view is it's going to last for some time.
What do you think, Wolf? When did it change? When did we become less civil?
You know, we all thought after 9/11 that we would be back at that level of civility in the political discourse of our country, that we would never again have the kind of bitter partisanship that had been so frequent in let's say during the Clinton years, for example, when things got ugly on many, many occasions. But we've recently seen, and I think Senator Dole will agree, a return to that kind of bitterness, that political acrimony, the kind of spirit that he doesn't like, the kind of spirit he's hoping will disappear, at least in the short term. Unfortunately, I'm not as upbeat as Senator Dole, because I sense in the coming days, especially after the sunset service tonight, politics are going to come back pretty quickly. All the bitterness is going to roar right back as we get closer to the conventions and the November 2nd election. It's just going to be a heated political campaign over the next few weeks and months. And I'm not sure that the Ronald Reagan national period of mourning is necessarily going to spill over and create a new era of goodwill, if you will.
But there'd be an opportunity.
Let's get what Senator Dole, what do you think of that? And then Ed Meese.
Well, I think probably, you know, Wolf is the expert, but I think you're going to see some of this again at the Republican convention. Obviously, Ronald Reagan is going to be a centerpiece in what happens at the Republican convention. That's going to be a message again to all the American people, not just Republicans. So my view is that it's going to last. I think, to be a little bit political, I think it's a plus for President Bush.
Ed?
Well, I've been concerned particularly. I don't know that we've ever had as much division between the parties while the nation has been at war. And we are at war right now, and I've been particularly disturbed by the attacks on the commander-in-chief, particularly from some of those who don't only disagree with his policies, but have made the attacks personal. And I think that kind of bitterness it doesn't belong in a country like ours.
But what caused it?
I don't know. Maybe it's has something to do with leadership. Maybe it has something to do with just the way in which the parties have perhaps gotten more hardened in their positions and perhaps more polarized.
Well, it's a very close division in Congress, too, and that always leads to, you know, more confrontation. And when it's 51-49 in the Senate, that makes it very difficult for either leader to have much of an impact.
That's true, and of
Gary
course...
Gary Foster, tell us... I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think that what Senator Dole has said is true. This the closeness and the division that is pretty close between the country as a whole, as revealed in polls and that sort of thing, probably is a contributing factor.
Gary Foster, what are we seeing now? Now, this is on the stage, right?
This is. You saw some honor guard getting in place, so it's obviously the motorcade is getting very close. But, you know, because this is a state funeral, the armed services are extremely involved in this entire proceedings over the last 6 days. So we have military bands, we have honor guards, guys moving the caskets are from all armed services. So you're going to see quite a bit of pomp and ceremony here, and it's all in place or getting in place as we watch.
And we have the U.S. Air Force Band and the U.S. Army Chorus, right?
That's correct. You're going to see a couple F-18s flying over at the end of the service, so it's you know, it's well represented by our armed services.
I think
plan going over now. Apparently, it's just a commercial jet. Senator Dole, you want to say something?
Well, I think that's what Gary said. We ought to also reflect upon the young men and women who are serving in Iraq and Afghanistan this week. We've lost soldiers this week. But I think when you see all these young men and women who participated this whole 5 days in all these ceremonies, it makes you proud. Proud of the young men, proud of the young women. And I know if President Reagan around, he'd be saluting left and right.
Also, watching the California Highway Patrol motorcycles going by the motorcade, just we were asked if it was possible if a lot of the guys who did that while he was president and governor were able to come up and have a special time before he left Simi Valley to go back to Washington to pay their respects. And we ended up having several thousand law enforcement officials from the LAPD, California Highway Patrol, multiple groups come up here at the very end of the laying in repose here in at the library on Monday, and it was quite emotional for those guys to all file by salute in their uniforms.
President Gorbachev, as a visitor to this country, what did you think of the service this morning?
Как гость страны, как оцениваете сегодняшнюю службу?
Я испытал.
I had the feeling that was very emotional when this farewell to the president was happening. The service was done with tremendous respect. It was extremely well organized. It was really very impressive. And perhaps all television channels showed moments of President Reagan's life and talked about his final years, and I think that that gave a lot of food for thought. I am now taking part in this conversation with you, and you have been discussing a number of themes and subjects, because those are kind of lessons, and these are the lessons that you are drawing from today and from yesterday. The American nation, I think, has shown, despite all differences that exist in a free society, in a democratic country, has shown itself quite unanimous in expressing the feeling of gratitude. And you may be right that this is precisely because people are comparing the politics of today and the politics of that time, particularly during the second term of his presidency.
Gary Foster, what can you tell us? Where are we now?
Well, we're here in the helicopter that's just above the motorcade, so he's just a matter of minutes away.
Now, give us how they come in here.
They're going to come up Presidential Drive,
which is
a winding road up
the
to the top.
Of presidents.
Yes, yes, with all 42 presidents on the way up.
Helicopter's now right above us.
And we'll arrive at the front of the library. Mrs. Reagan will get out of her limousine. Once she's in place, the casket will be removed from the hearse. It will be transported through the courtyard of the library, through the library itself, and out into the backyard for the ceremony.
Following the ceremony, the burial, will that take part of it too, the placing of the body in the ground?
Yes, once the ceremony is over, the casket will proceed over to the place of burial. Mrs. Reagan will follow, be put in place. She will be allowed a few moments to say her final goodbye. Reverend Vining, who is their pastor, will say an invocation, taps the 21-gun salute and the folding of the flag and present it to Mrs. Reagan. It's going to be quite emotional. The casket, Askley, is going to be preceded by a bagpipe that will be playing Amazing Grace that I think will be very, very emotional.
At some services, they'll throw pebbles on the casket or some sort of reminder of people's association.
All the guests here, all 700 guests, once Mrs. Reagan leaves, will be able to file by, so I'm sure we will see everybody paying respects in their own way.
And now we have pulling in right behind us about five or six California Highway Patrolmen on motorcycles. We hear a helicopter directly above our heads, which you're seeing, of course, and we are where now? We are looking out. Is that Simi Valley?
This is Simi Valley, and we're on one of the mountaintops overlooking the valley. As you were talking earlier, it's a spectacular sight that this library sits on top of.
The library is right sort of there behind us,
That's correct, right over our shoulder.
This is some scene, Senator Dole. I wish you were here. This is an incredible setting. Have you been to this library?
I've been there. I had the great honor to speak there on one occasion, and it is a beautiful sight. Stanford University made a big mistake when they're the losers, and they deserve to lose because all those liberal professors didn't want anything to do with President Reagan.
What is that story? I don't know.
Well, I think maybe Ed Meese could fill you in, but I think that's the original plan. I may be wrong, but...
No, Larry, originally the thought was that the presidential library would be up on Stanford University in Northern California, where it would be close to the Hoover Institution, where a number of people had worked for the Reagan administration. And there were some objections on the campus there, unfortunately, from some of the more liberal people. Ronald Reagan said, well, if there's going to be any controversy, we'll find someplace else. And of course, they found it. What is probably, in the long run, a much better spot down where it is now in Simi Valley. It's a beautiful place. I was honored to be on one of the trustees, the founding trustees that built the library initially, and it's just a marvelous site, and I think in the long run it worked out for the best, which is kind of typical of Ronald Reagan, I think, in what's happened in his life.
Now, I had the honor of speaking here once, and I noticed that Senator Howard Baker is coming to speak in August, and Justice O'Connor will be speaking here in September. That's a regular thing right here.
Yes,
Gary.
They have outstanding speakers on a regular basis come up on as part of the library program.
It's a beautiful library, and a great part of it also, if you're visiting out here, and they're expecting tons of visitors, was to see the motorcade coming sort of up the hill. There's a great tribute to his days as an actor. Lots of posters and pictures and sights and sounds around Beverly Hills and Los Angeles. Have you been here, Wolf?
Yes, I've been there, Larry, and it is a fabulous place to visit, to experience history. Anyone who wants to learn something about Ronald Reagan will appreciate what's going on. The other day, when I was in Normandy, France, covering the D-Day anniversary, Douglas Brinkley, the presidential historian, was there. He was just there not that long ago, a few weeks ago, and he had some access to some of Ronald Reagan's diaries. And he told us a story, Larry, and I'm sure Gary might want to weigh in on this, that when Ronald Reagan was president, every single day, virtually every single day, he was so disciplined, he would handwrite
he would write with his own words some thoughts of what happened that day, some reflections. He didn't dictate them to a secretary or to a machine. He would just simply write in his diary, and those diaries are going to be made available to historians in the not-too-distant future. And I think another side of Ronald Reagan, yet another dimension, will come forward. I don't know if Gary wants to talk about that or if he's had access to those diaries, but it's going to be a fascinating new treasure trove for historians and biographers.
Well, Wolf is right, and as Attorney General Meese can say, witness this, Ronald Reagan wrote most of his speeches longhand before he was elected president, and so he's a fabulous writer, and he was encouraged and challenged to actually chronicle, every day, as Wolf said, his presidency, and so we will have access to those at some point, which I'm sure will be, every historian will be fascinated by.
Ed, you ever read any of it?
I have never read any, but he told me about some of the entries that he's made over the years. And I think it's correct. He was a very disciplined person. There's another aspect to his discipline, which was why he was so healthy, and that is that he also worked out every night. Those were the two things he did. Do his exercises, treadmill and weightlifting, and also write in his daily journal.
Now the motorcade is coming up the hill, coming right to the library. We've had quite a number of motorcycle cops pull into the area where we are already. What's the purpose of the helicopter, Gary?
Well, it's a combination of security, but we also had a helicopter up there with a camera in it, so the world will continue to be able to see the coverage. But there's always a security helicopter above every motorcade movement.
Where are we
can
right
I ask, Larry, can I ask Gary a question? Why the family didn't want that helicopter shot on the motorcade that brought the casket and Mrs. Reagan from the presidential library the other day to the Point Magoo Naval Air Station, yet on the return, they've invited the media to show this motorcade virtually going the whole way.
It was not the family's decision. Unfortunately, in this era in which we live in, there's probably no fewer than a dozen agencies that had to approve it, and unfortunately, we did not get all those agencies to approve it. And in fact, the Secret Service agent that's in charge of this entire event, he was on the phone this morning with Homeland Security to finally get the approval for the helicopter today. But airspace and all security arrangements have been elevated just tremendously, even since I was in the White House 10 years ago, because of the era in which we live in today.
Where is the hearse now, Gary?
This is Presidential Drive, just literally a matter of a few hundred feet away from where we're sitting. So we should be seeing that.
Will it come
hearse
right behind us here?
Yes, come right behind us.
Okay, we're sort of around this bend here, right?
Yes, yes. This is part of the windy road up to the library.
If you come to this library, if you're ever out in the Simi Valley area in California, and it's about on an easy traffic day, about an hour from Los Angeles.
From Los Angeles, that's correct.
Straight up the 405, which is kind of a parking lot, but sometimes
on a good day, it's an hour.
And these cars are now winding up. We expect them to come right by us momentarily. And then again, they will go to the front of the building.
Yes.
The casket will be removed.
Yes.
Carried through, the viewers will get to see them carried through the main entrance.
Carried through the courtyard into the main entrance of the library, through the library momentarily, and into the back lawn, which is where we will see the sunset.
I mean, Larry, is it getting a little, the sun's still out there, right? I mean, it's getting a little, not quite as bright as it was earlier.
Are we going to be playing it close, Gary, here on sunset? When is sunset?
No, actually, because it's a little bit later, I think it's even going to be that much more dramatic, because the sun won't set until actually behind the mountains about 7:45. So once the service is about over, we will see the sun disappear behind the mountains.
In other words, if they start this in 7-8 minutes, this will be right at sunset.
Yes, this will be perfect timing, actually.
So what we're saying, Gary, is you deliberately slowed this down.
Yeah,
to
down
create an exact sunset arrival.
This is exactly what we hope, to tell you the truth.
Through the keen eyes of Senator Dole, who observes weather well.
That's
correct. We have some military men standing near us right here, over to our left, awaiting the arrival of the presidential motorcade. Do you have events like this in Russia, President Gorbachev?
России бывают подобные мероприятия?
Наверное, все-таки другая.
Well, I would say that the tradition is different. Although, of course, there is a farewell. And there is the viewing of the body in the coffin. And there is music that accompanies the event. And there are remarks and speeches made at the civil service.
I want to interrupt you, Mr. President, just a moment. The hearse is, this is the hearse, is it not?
Yes.
Passing right by us, Gary. We are right next to it. And there we see the flag-draped coffin. The car's behind us. And as they pull around this turn, they're going to be right at the entrance to the building, right?
That's correct. That's correct. And you see it stop and Mrs. Reagan get out of her limo momentarily.
Is the wind blowing out there a little?
Not bad.
No, but there's a nice breeze, but it's not too bad.
Larry, once the service is it a one-hour service? Is that what we anticipate?
Yeah, right, Gary?
Yes, it'll take about
1 hour. The way I read it, it's one hour service.
That's correct.
I want to thank Senator Dole. I know he's going to be leaving us. We'll hang out here and watch this whole thing along with you, and then have a wind-up and have our guests comment at the end of this service what they thought about it. But I know Senator Dole have to leave us. Thank you much, Bob.
Thank you, Larry. It's a great honor to be on
the program.
Always
great seeing you.
Honor President Reagan.
Thank you. Our honor to have you. And thanks for staying so late, running almost 45 minutes late from the start of things. We actually took the air hosting this program almost an hour ago. Now, Gary, where will you go?
Well, if you don't mind, I'd like to go take my seat at the service. And
I don't mind at all. Give my best to my wife.
I sure will. I'm sorry you're not going to be able to join us, but I understand.
Thank you. But someone has to do this,
Gary. That's right.
It might as well be me. Wolf Blitzer will be standing by. Ed Meese will be standing by. Mikhail Gorbachev will be standing by at the Hilton Hotel in Houston. We thank Bob Dole for being with us. Candy Crowley is on the scene. We'll be checking in with her as you watch the family disembark and head toward the centerpiece of the library, the main entrance to the library. Let's see if we can pick up any sound. Let's just watch.
Thank you.
that stage area there. And of course, Nancy will be laid to rest next to him when she joins him. The ceremony is almost 50 minutes late in starting. That was due to some planned lateness. With the enormous crowds along the highway and streets along the way on the route from the Naval Air Station to here. And now there seems to be some slow up here. I don't know what this is. Ed Meese, you have a guess as to what this might be? I guess as Ed isn't connected with us. Wolf?
I think what they wanted was to give the family a chance, Larry, to freshen up inside before they emerged. But yeah. They had that long drive in from the Naval Air Station. They wanted to give Mrs. Reagan and everyone a chance to simply freshen up a little bit. Now the family, we see them walking out for this service about to begin. The immediate children, of course, of Ronald and Nancy Reagan and Michael Reagan himself. Right there with his wife as well. I don't think there was anything more to it than simply that, Larry.
I agree, Wolf. Good thinking. Here comes the rest of the procession that are filing in. They'll take their seats in the front. There are a total of about 700 people here. And as we told you earlier, most all of them close friends of the president and or the first lady. They now take their seats in the front. This ceremony is moments away from beginning in this beautiful setting, northwest of Los Angeles, Simi Valley, California. The folks are being seated. The program is about to start. If they stay to the program we've been handed in front of us, there'll be four ruffles and flourishes and the playing of Hail to the Chief. It's a poem by Sir Walter Scott, music by James Sanderson. Hail to the Chief, first associated with the United States Chief Executive in 1815, when it was played to honor George Washington at the end of the War of 1812. First living president to be honored was Andrew Jackson in 1829. There's Ron Reagan and Michael Reagan and their wives. You see Mrs. Thatcher directly behind Ron Reagan, the president's youngest son. Arnold Schwarzenegger, you see the top of Arnold's head, and he is behind, well, sort of in between Ron Reagan and Michael Reagan's wife. The rest of the party comes in. The sun, as they tell us, an hour away from setting. This was planned as a sunset burial. Proceedings should start momentarily. Let's watch.